What's up, Green Bay Packers fans? Welcome back, and as always, thank you for joining me. My name is Paul Brettle. Today, we're here to discuss my three big things ahead of the Green Bay Packers playoff matchup with the Dallas Cowboys. But first, hit like on the video, hit subscribe on the YouTube channel. I greatly appreciate it. As always, you can find all my work over at Packers Wire, and you can follow me on Twitter at Paul_Brettle. So like I said, and I have this up in article version every single week over at Packers Wire, my three big things, what you need to keep your eyes on as the game unfolds between the Packers and the Cowboys. So let's dive in. Let's start with Aaron Jones and the run game. Since returning from injury, Aaron Jones has eclipsed the 100-yard mark in games. Of course, that's a product of Aaron Jones just being Aaron Jones. Matt LaFleur, Jordan Love have both gone on and on and on about his contributions, his ability to spark this offense, and we've seen that throughout Aaron Jones' career. But I also want to touch on the offensive line because they're playing their best football right now. That Bears game in particular, those were some of the best running lanes that they've created all season long. And that was one of the better run defenses in football. The Bears were allowing just 3.7 yards per rush entering that game. Aaron Jones, like I said, eclipsed the 100 yards mark, averaged over 5 yards per carry. And in the locker room after, asked John Runyon if he felt like his offensive line unit as a whole was playing some of their best football right now, and he agreed. And of course, that's the ultimate goal this time of the year. How healthy are teams and how good of football are they playing going into the playoffs? And one point that Runyon made it is he gave credit to the coaching staff, specifically putting the offensive linemen in positions to be successful, knowing where each of those players excel, and then asking them to go out and execute on those responsibilities regardless of what the defense is doing. And really, that's what good teams do. That's what good units, position groups do. Of course, you make adjustments week to week based on who you're going up against, how they operate, all of those things. But at the end of the day, you still have your core, you know, who you are, your fundamentals, how you run your offense, and just go out there and execute on it. And that's what the Packers offensive line is doing right now. And as we look to this matchup with the Dallas Cowboys, again, a very good defense, the run game has been the recipe this season for opponents to find success against them. And the Cowboys had 5 losses in the regular season. In 3 of those 5 losses, they gave up 170-plus rushing yards, including 2 times where the opponent had over 200 yards on the ground. The other 2 losses that Dallas had, they gave up 109 yards and 91 yards. So success in the run game has been a formula for success for some of Dallas's opponents this year, specifically in the games that they've lost. And when you're able to generate that success on the ground game, when you have that ability to lean on it, it's going to open up opportunities in the passing game. That's something Jordan Love has talked about constantly. Oftentimes that comes off of play action, where Love and this offense have been extremely efficient. And also, it helps take away some of the bite from the pass rush. When you're in not in predictable passing situations, so you're not in 2nd and long, 3rd and longs, but rather it's 2nd and 4, 3rd and 2, that opens up the entire playbook for Matt LaFleur. You can really do anything from a play calling standpoint when you're in those down and distance situations. And so I asked Elton Jenkins about this, and this was back after the Kansas City game, about when the run game's going, you have play action to lean on, you're staying ahead of the sticks, what does that do for you as an offense alignment? And it gives the offense alignment a bit of an advantage, because the pass rushers, they can't just go from point A to point B, because on 2nd and 3, the opportunity is still there for the offense to run the ball. So there is that split second of, I'll use hesitation for lack of a better term, but deciphering what's taking place. And as we all know in the NFL, that's all that needs to take place for the offensive lineman to get the upper hand, to get into position, to be positioned properly, to execute on what his responsibilities are. So getting the run game going, like I said, it's been a recipe for success for some of Dallas's opponents this season. Packers, Aaron Jones, the offensive line are playing some of their best football in that regard as well. But there's also just a massive trickle-down effect to the rest of the offense, and that's going to be really important when you're going up against Micah Parsons and this Dallas pass rush. When you're going up against this aggressive Dallas secondary, it's done a really good job of generating takeaways. Last thing I'll mention on this, when it comes to the run game, also allows you to control the time of possession. On the opposite side of the field is a Cowboys offense where the team as a whole has won 16 straight games at home, and this Cowboys offense is averaging just under 30 points per game this season. They led the NFL in that category. So if the Packers offense can help their defense out by stringing together some long drives, controlling the time of possession, just limiting the overall number of possessions in this game, that's going to be in their favor against a high-powered Dallas offense that they'll be going up against on the other side. Next up, number two, limiting Dak Prescott in this Cowboys passing game. And ultimately, that's going to start with the Green Bay Packers pass rush, getting after him, generating pressures, but more importantly, turning those pressure opportunities into sacks. Like I said, Cowboys offense averaged just under 30 points per game this season, led the NFL in that category. They averaged the third most passing yards per game in the NFL. CeeDee Lamb had a whopping 179 targets this season, nearly 1,800 receiving yards. If the Packers go about, you know, putting extra defenders his way, trying to limit his responsibility or his production, I should say, you know, Dallas still has other guys who can make plays in this passing game. Tight end Jake Ferguson had nearly 800 receiving yards. He ranked top 10 among all tight ends in that category. Brandon Cooks at receiver had nearly 700 yards on his own. There is no, you know, perfect way to go about defending this group, because it's, again, CeeDee Lamb's the one you got to be worried about the most, of course, but there's other guys in this offense that can make plays and hurt you. So it's not just about taking CeeDee Lamb away. It's what are the other guys doing? And if we see the Packers, you know, hopefully they learned from how they went about going after attacking the Tampa Bay, and I use the word attacking loosely, but the Tampa Bay offense with Mike Evans, where a lot of their emphasis was on him. A lot of their emphasis, as they talked about afterwards, was trying to limit the big plays in the passing game. If you take that heavy shell coverage approach, which Joe Barry has a tendency to do, can create a lot of pitch and catch opportunities underneath, easy completions, yards after the catch. So Packers have to do something different this time around. But regardless of what the game plan is, any sort of success that this defense is going to have starts with getting after Dak Prescott. If at the end of the day, and it's not going to matter what Joe Barry calls, if Prescott regularly has 4+ seconds to hang in the pocket to find the open receiver, that's just too long to ask this Packers secondary to cover these Cowboys pass catchers, especially if the Packers end up being without Jaire Alexander, who, from what Matt LaFleur had to say on Friday, sounds like he's truly going to be a game time decision. But just because the Packers are able to generate pressure, that doesn't guarantee them success either against Dak Prescott. From a completion percentage standpoint, Dak Prescott is, I believe, ranked first in the NFL in completion percentage when under pressure this season. He's been one of the best at yards per attempt, again, when under pressure this season. So even getting after him, even giving him off his spot, disrupting the timing, disrupting the rhythm of the play, isn't going to guarantee you success against this offense. A decent percentage, and of course this is relatively speaking, but a decent percentage of those pressures are going to have to be turned into sacks, because again, Dak has shown that even with pressure, he and this offense can still remain really, really effective and still playing at a high level. The Green Bay pass rush has been much more productive as of late, and I really do attribute that to the improved play from the interior defensive line. These last two games in particular, I thought they've done an excellent job of generating push up the middle, helping to keep the quarterback in the pocket, allowing the edge rushers to close in to get home, and we're going to absolutely have to see the Packers find success in that area. Like I said, and continue to reiterate, pressures are great. They're very, very important. Has to happen, but sacks are what's going to be a must in this game for the Packers defense. And I know that might sound like a really obvious statement, but oftentimes pressures are king. And when it comes to the Green Bay Packers, when the game's over, they're going back and they're reevaluating their performance, you know, they measure defensive success based on how many pressures are generated. Again, for the reasons mentioned, because those can be so disruptive. The timing, the rhythm of the play, getting the quarterback off his spot, oftentimes that leads to inaccurate throws, leads to mistakes, turnover opportunities. Like I said, because of how Dak has handled it this season, because of the pass catchers that he has around him, even doing that doesn't guarantee success against this Cowboys offense. And like I said, the Packers are getting better, or have been better as of late, in generating pressures and also converting those pressure opportunities into sacks. And when I was talking to Kenny Clark about it, you know, he brought up the youth along that interior defensive line. And it's, of course, it's not to the extent of what the receiver tight end room is, because of course you have a Kenny Clark there, but it is a young group of guys. You know, they have two rookies in Brooks and Wooden they're relying heavily on. Devontae Wyatt is only in his second season, and he only played like 21% of the snaps as a rookie. TJ Slayton's in year three, and this is really his first year, you know, being in that starting role, relied on as heavily as he has been this season. So when we look at the trajectory of this interior defensive line unit this season, you know, they're a young group too, who seems to be finding their footing, getting a better understanding of what their specific, you know, responsibilities, roles, and really just the consistency of it. That's what every young player is chasing, is consistency. And we're starting to see more of that. And I feel like the end result is we're seeing a more impactful pass rush from the interior as well. But that element is going to be really, really important for the Packers. They come into this game finishing the regular season ranked 6th in pressure rate overall. Of course, very good. But in terms of total sacks, they're middle of the pack. They rank 16th. So definitely an area to keep our eyes on. Not just pressures, but they're going to have to bring Dak Prescott down. Last thing, generating explosive plays on the offense for this Green Bay Packers team. You know, the recipe last season, and I get, you know, every season's different. You know, we can't just strictly look at how the Packers perform, especially with the team being so different in 2022 compared to where they are now. But when they played the Cowboys at home, when they beat this Dallas defense, you know, the recipe was success on the ground. Aaron Jones and A.J. Dillon, I believe, had like 37 combined carries in that game, totaled 200 rushing yards. And I'm sure, as we all remember, that was also the Christian Watson breakout game. It was a heavy, heavy dose of the run game with some explosive pass plays sprinkled in. And that ultimately led to the Packers' victory against Dallas last season. Again, different players, completely different team. But that formula is, feels like, once again, is going to have to be the Packers' path to victory against Dallas this time around as well. Dallas defense has been top 10 in the NFL in terms of creating takeaways. Like I mentioned earlier, the secondary is very, very aggressive, and they play a heavy, heavy dose of man coverage. So before we get too far ahead of ourselves, if the end result that the Packers want and that they're striving for is the big pass play, step one is protecting Jordan Love and giving him time in the pocket. Again, not going to be an easy task, because across that line is Micah Parsons. Micah Parsons finished the regular season with 103 pressures. It's the most in the NFL. And what this Dallas defense does with him so well is they move him around. This is not just a Rashid Walker or a Zach Tom problem. This is an entire offensive line problem that they're going to have to contend with. They do a really good job of moving him around, finding him preferred matchups, one-on-one matchups that obviously he's able to take advantage of. Like Matt LaFleur said this past week, he's a freak show. You know, Micah Parsons is an absolute one of those players who single-handedly can wreck a game. Packers have to have an answer for him. And Matt LaFleur also mentioned that, Parsons is going to garner the attention, understandably so. This is a Dallas pass rush that has other guys as well. It's not just about trying to double team, trying to take away Parsons. There are other guys who can absolutely make noise in this game. And Matt LaFleur said, watching that pass rush on film, said it's like carnage going after the quarterback. So Cowboys enter this game ranked 1st in ESPN's pass rush win rate. So offensive line, Jordan Love is going to have to be very, very good at handling the pressure. And credit to Jordan Love, of all the areas that he's improved upon during the second half of the season, his ability to handle pressure and function with it has been very, very, very good. I was thinking back to after the Lions game, and I wrote an article about how Love's handled the pressure, and, you know, mentioned Tom Clements, the quarterback coach's comments. You know, after that Lions game, he was asked specifically, where's Jordan Love improved the most? And he talked about how his decision-making in those split-second situations specifically when under pressure. And from that Lions game, he referenced a 22-yard check down to A.J. Dillon. If you recall, I think that's the one where A.J. Dillon hurdled a player or made an attempt to. And that play was designed to go downfield. But as that play was developing, the pressure got to Love. He quick turned to Dillon, knew exactly where to go with the ball, still turned into an explosive gain. Clements referenced that as being a pivotal moment and a prime example of the strides that Jordan Love has made as a quarterback, again, with his decision-making when under pressure. And go back and watch the Vikings game. Go back and watch the Bears game. Not that Love was under a ton of pressure in those contests, but when he was, he's someone, you know, who's been in complete control of this offense, and it really shows when he's under pressure. It starts pre-snap with Josh Myers reading the personnel, reading the defensive linemen, setting the protection. Love using the hard count, looking at late movements, adjusting any sort of protection adjustments that need, or making any sort of protection adjustments that need to be made. And then when, as the play's unfolding, if there's someone who comes through, there is no, you know, no rush, no hesitation from Love. It's as if he knows exactly where the pressure might be coming from. And when it does, he knows exactly where to go with the ball. That's going to be incredibly important against this Cowboys pass rush that, like I said, has been really, really good at getting after the quarterback. Now, having said all that, if the offensive line can hold up, if Jordan Love can continue to play at a high level when under pressure, the opportunity for some explosive pass plays could be there. As I mentioned originally, this is a Cowboys defense that does play a ton of man coverage. And while they have that man coverage element, they have that aggressiveness, they've also been pretty good at limiting big plays through the air this season. So it's not going to be easy, but if Jordan Love has time, there are going to be one-on-one matchups for his receivers. And this Packers group of receivers in particular against man coverage this season have been really, really effective. And if Christian Watson is available, it would be massive for this Packers team. There's the obvious big playability that he brings on his own. But when you have that speed, that presence that he brings on the football field, everybody benefits. Creates better spacing. There's more room to operate for other pass catchers to take advantage of. And when you have players like Jaden Reed, Dontavian Wicks, who have shown just a sixth sense and innate ability to get open, to find the soft spot in defenses, you know, that opportunity when you have Watson out there can be magnified again because of the additional spacing he creates, because of the gravity that he has, and hopefully leads to some explosive plays for the Green Bay Packers offense. So there you have it. Those are my three big things going into the Green Bay Packers matchup with the Dallas Cowboys. As always, I appreciate you tuning in. Hit like on the video, hit subscribe on the YouTube channel. I greatly appreciate it. As always, you can find all my work over at Packers Wire, and you can follow me on Twitter at Paul_Brettel. So until next time, friends, take care, stay safe, and as always, go Pack, go.